Hello, and welcome to The Knit Girls. This is episode 340. I'm Laura, also known as Lala.
I'm Leslie, also known as You Don't Call Me Les. It is Monday, March the 13th, 2017, and it is the week of our first Portland retreat.
It's pie week, right? Isn't
tomorrow it? Tomorrow is 314.
Yeah. I need to find some pie tomorrow.
But more importantly... We have our first Portland retreat this week. So,
The Ides of March are this week, too.
I thought the Ides of March was the 5th of March.
15th. Oh. I'm pretty sure.
Oh, yeah, I'm thinking of Cinco de Mayo, which is the 5th of May. Numbers.
But more importantly.
Yeah. There's our episode title right there. Yeah, so this is a knitting show.
No, it's not.
We've done this at least 340 times.
You would think.
Yet we still find new and spectacular ways to fail. So
always.
Welcome.
That's like, you know, people talk about their superhero power. Mm. Our superhero power is finding unique ways to fail.
Yes.
And then rebound.
What was really funny was, I used to, before I switched to, working in corporate IT for my company, I worked at the property IT, which is, you know, like I worked at a branch instead of the main office, essentially.
You worked at an actual casino.
Right. And when the company that bought us needed to convert our system to their system so that we could all use the same system, you know, they do all these integrations and conversions. And they have to do what's called break testing, which is basically bring in a monkey, have it hit the keyboard, and see how many ways you can make it break.
Oh, okay.
That way you can fix it before it goes out to the general population. I was that monkey. I was the break tester.
That's pretty awesome,
I'm very good at finding ways to fail. Anyway.
Cool.
Knitting-wise, would you like to go or would you like me to?
Well, you go. Because sure. I'm about to decrease on the sleeve.
Okay. Laura's been very single-minded this week, which you'll see soon. So I have a couple of things. I'm working on my March Desert Vista Dye Work socks. So I'm only on the first one. And this is Somebody Loves the Knit Girls. Red. Yay. And purple, because red, purple.
I'm not wearing purple today. But I'm wearing gray, which is the second best color.
Susan of Desert Vista Dye Works does an annual sort of unclub where you just knit a pair of socks a month in her yarn. And there's details on the Desert Vista Dye Works group. I'm not going to detour into that because that'll take a while. But, yeah, I'm knitting these. And I'm just going a simple, very simple pattern with a slip stitch heel. Nothing fancy. Because I need to be able to knit on these while I'm in class with Hohi or Vera.
So you need to pack supplies, too, for your classes.
Oh.
There's no homework, but you need to pack supplies.
You said supplies, and I'm like, do I need a machete? Like, what
yes.
am I taking
yes.
with me
you
to Portland?
You need a machete to go to Portland. Good luck getting it on
it's
the plane.
It's the rule. So, yeah. Well, I always have, like, a notions bag of stuff with me.
But... Yeah, but you need specific things.
Oh, okay. I'll get with you.
It's listed in the group.
Okay. So that's the first thing that lives in... I always have a pair of socks in this bag. This is a Tom Benn bag, and it's got...
A clear bottom.
Yeah, a clear bottom, which is very helpful. And then Laura got me a narwhal / northern light /...
awesome. There's bears. A narwhal right
there. That's what I was looking for. From Amy Beth, the Fat Squirrel... Speaks. She's not Fat Squirrel Fibers anymore.
But that's what her bags are under.
Yes, okay. And I am knitting the Meraki tank. God, I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Meraki or Mirakai, I don't know.
How do you spell it? Meraki.
Yeah. So this just has general information that you can find on the Ravelry page, so I'll show it. So it's this tank, and it's very simple. It's bottom up. It's got a lace panel on one side, and then on the other side, it's got a little keyhole.
Ooh, I do like the appreciate the keyhole.
So you can wear it either way.
Yeah.
I plan on adding sleeves to it.
Itty-bitty sleeves? Or, no. like, full-blown?
Not full, but, like, you know, half bicep sleeves or something. And...
How do you intend to do
that? I'm not sure yet. I'm researching a couple different methods, but I'm not completely sure how I'm going to do it yet.
Amy Beth is, like, the queen of
knowing how to do stuff. She is. She's the queen of all that random crap. She's very brainy.
Amy Beth, queen of random crap.
We're
getting you a crown for SSK.
Yes.
It might be a Burger King crown that with puffy paint says Amy Beth, queen of random crap.
So I'm using Plymouth Nettle Grove.
Gosh, we're so ridiculous.
Surprisingly, is what the pattern calls for. This might be only the second or third time I've ever knit with what the pattern actually calls for. And I owned the pattern before I owned, or owned the yarn before I owned the pattern. So last week I had just finished the ribbing. This past week, during work when time permitted, I was able to knit. So I've got about 5 inches, maybe almost 6 inches. And I've been doing waist shaping, little decreases on the sides. And Laura's been doing this on hers as well, which she'll show you, but I've been marking them.
Oh, look at you. You're
with
so
these
fancy.
Little bulb stitch markers for every decrease so that I don't have to
count.
Yeah, go back and count all the stitches.
That's interesting. So, I didn't do that on my sweater body, but I do on the sleeves, so I can make sure I'm decreasing the same on both sides.
I'll have to. I'm already modifying the pattern because my stitch gauge is different from their stitch gauge. So I'm sort of, my stitch gauge is bigger, but I'm doing a smaller size. I did the math and it worked. I did the math twice and it worked.
You did the math twice? You should have had Noah look at your math.
I should have. But it's going really well. The yarn is really not very bad on my hands. It's
did you wash the swatch?
Very smooth, yes.
Mm-hmm. Did it soften when you washed it?
Mm-hmm. It's already pretty soft. I mean...
Yeah, it is soft.
It
feels like it's got Tencel in it.
It has... 45% cotton, 28% linen, 12% nettle fiber, and 15% silk.
Hmm.
So,
that silk is probably what I'm feeling.
Yeah. It does soften after a wash, but it's not bad to work with.
What are the washing directions like?
Picking veg matter out. You can machine wash it cold, but then it's best to lay it out flat. You can tumble dry it on cool, but I would just forget and it would end up wrinkled.
Yeah.
So, just laying it out is the best for me. So, yeah, that's pretty much what I'm working on right now and what I'll probably continue to work on as we note, because I'm getting close to a decrease and I don't have just a literal crap ton of those stitch markers. So,
hold on. Oh, that was totally my phone.
Well, now it's totally down
hey,
there.
Hey, look, there's a bucket full of bulbs.
I have
a bunch. I'm going to leave some right here for you, okay?
Thank you.
Wait, there's more in my pocket.
What do you keep in your pocket? Is it bulb stitch markers?
And assorted colors?
Yeah.
I'm going to take the colored ones back when I leave. Because I like the colored ones best.
Yeah, they stick out a lot more.
So
that's it for me.
Amazing.
Laura has made so much progress this week. It is sickening.
Man, I feel like it's not. But
you knit almost an entire sweater this week.
Hey, I've got a sweater. But not really, almost. So this is the Radiate sweater from Interpretations number 4.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
The one that just came out.
It is a sweater by Hohe Locatelli. I am using, so this colored bit at the top is hand spun from our friend Lynn. She gifted me some hand spun out of Gail's art. So I'm using that. And the gray is Ross Farms Jacob
mm-hmm.
in the... it was someone whose name...
I forget the name.
It was like Emily or Julia or...
Don't know.
I can't remember. Anyway.
But last week you weren't even done with the yoke. Like,
was
you
I
were,
not?
No. You hadn't separated for sleeves yet.
That's true. I hadn't. Hey, look, there's a body now.
And a sleeve. And
one
most
full
of
sleeve.
Another.
And most of another. So, I did the yoke as written. Completely as written. And then when I separated, I thought, because I didn't try it on, that it was like right at the bust. So I added a couple stitches, but it's a little bit below the bust. So it's a little bit loose. I did the size 46. My actual bust measurement is a 46, but I know for me, swatches lie.
Mm-hmm.
They are dirty liars. Like, it's a good way to get a ballpark for me. But I knit looser in an overall finished item unless I'm knitting on a deadline. Then it might get a little bit tight. So here, let me take off my hoodie. I'll try it on. Remind me to grab my phone before I leave, by the way.
You would get out of that chair without your phone in hand.
Addiction.
You're as glued to it as my teenager can be.
So I have around 20 in Sweetbone, which is not too bad. I'm hoping to get this blocked tonight. Monkey sleeves. So that it has a hole, because it needs a good wet blocking. I'm getting it's farm fresh yarn, so it has a little bit of veg matter. What Leslie was referring to is I use bulb stitch markers to mark every single decrease, and I'm doing that for twofold. I'm doing that first because I want my sleeves to be the same. But second, I'm decreasing like every sixth row, so then I just have to count back to the stitch marker. So that's making it a little bit easier. The sleeves, actually, I did not knit the full 19.5 inches. Usually my measurement is 19.5, but I think I did around 18.5 instead, because it was long enough.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking it's going to grow a little bit. Then almost done. Almost done.
She was trying to have it done before we recorded.
I was, but a lovely lady named Laura. She's got the name. It's the best. She had put a post on the Shocked Spinners board asking if anyone in Memphis had a ladybug she could try. And I happen to have a ladybug, so I invited her over, and so she came to the house, which means that I had to actually clean the house. Because you gotta clean before you have people in.
I have been in a feverish clean because your parents are coming. I totally understand.
They are. Anyway, so this is a little bit of a bulky, like, let me stand up. So once it's like bulky in that it's not a fitted sweater, which I am totally okay on. I don't know if you can see it on the side. I did do a little bit of waist shaping. And then I increase out a little bit more than the pattern called for because I'm a little bit wider on my, I just made the whole thing rough. On my back 40 than,
Your back 40.
I know, it was a knitmore expression. I've been listening to the Knitmore Girls a lot.
I now picture somebody playing golf on your behind, yes. So, anyway.
Well, that would be, like, back 18, yeah, not back 40.
The back 9, I think that's
what it's called. Or 9, yeah. Or golf, whatever. So, it's a looser fitting sweater, but it's meant to be layered, because Jacob's not the softest of wools. It's not like super scratchy, but it's not merino, so it's gonna be layered. So anyway, I have this much of a sleeve left, and then I'm going to remove the pins, put them back in their holder before I lose them. And then weave in ends, give it a good wash and block tonight. It is going in the guest room bed on my blocking boards. Turn the fan on and hopefully it will dry by the time I need to pack tomorrow.
If you flip it in the morning, it should help it too.
Yeah, I think it'll dry. I mean, it's been super damp here. So here's a side note. I have a fence post that's rotted that my parents are kindly fixing for me when they come. But Wheezy wanted me to walk out. It's like in the back of my property.
And Laura's yard is sort of pie shaped.
Yeah.
And the big part of the pie is her backyard. And it's got like 5 yards that border on it.
Yep. So all that's holding this fence up right now is the corner where it's hanging onto one of my neighbor's fences. So he's going to fix it because he is amazing. But he insisted that he needed like 5 pictures, at least 5 pictures of this fence. I don't know what good pictures are going to do, but whatever, he needed them. So it's been like misting and raining all day. And it has been like every single day.
It has precipitated in some
form
or another. We
got snow too.
Yes.
But my lawn really needs to be mowed too, which is so ridiculous because we got snow. Yeah. I don't know what's happening. Anyway, so the weather's so miserable. I'm like, hey, Pearl, let's go out back and take pictures of the fence. And she was like, peace. Yeah. I'm going to be right here.
I'm cool where I am, thanks.
Eating some food. I'm not even going to look at the door at you. It'll be cool. Yeah. Talk to you later.
Yep.
But anyway, Love the sweater. Directions are written really, really clear and concise. It's sized really well, and I think actually I'm gonna knit it again. I think I'm going to knit it where I use a fleece and use the bottom, and then use a special braid of handspun again for the top. It's like the perfect sweater for handspun. I agree.
Mixing your colored handspun with your fleece.
Yeah, and it's a nice oversized, like, when it's cold outside, like...
Or you could make it more fitted if you wanted.
Yeah, I totally could. Yeah, definitely. I like things oversized. In case you couldn't tell. That's what she said. But, yeah, I'm really enjoying it. There's some other patterns in that collection that I want to knit. Vera's got a sweater that's got some, different,
she just came out
like,
with a sweater
color.
Called Confetti that's awesome for speckled yarns.
Ooh.
And it's beautiful. It's totally going to get knit.
Good. I have a knit by you or knit by Gwen?
I don't know yet.
I have a couple
patterns. I
kind of
knit it myself just because I don't use speckled yarn as much as I would like, but I own a lot of it.
So I want to do Vera's, the one that you have, that Gwen knit you.
Breathing Space.
Breathing Space. That's, I have... shockingly, some gray Volmiza that I'm going to add with maybe a skein of, like, Petite Poison.
Mm-hmm.
Some purple. Or I have some other skeins that I can use, too. So that's going to happen.
That is a good use. Like, the stripes are good use for sort of a not variegated so much. Well, I guess sort of.
Yeah, super variegated.
Yeah.
Because it's not going to pool, weirdly.
Right.
It's such a short...
It's only in two rows.
Yeah. And she's got the one in interpretations I like. And then, I promised my friend Farrell that I would knit a flex with her.
Hmm.
So, because I have a lot of worsted weight yarn. I have a lot of Madtosh. Like, I have Madtosh Tart that I might use.
Hmm. That's a good color.
That's a good color. And that's a good, another, like, good pullover.
Yeah, just sort of.
Type sweater.
Comfy sitting around drinking coffee.
Yeah, or to wear to work with with khakis.
That works too.
Because
my work wardrobe, like if I had to start going into the office, I might have two outfits I could wear.
I wear dresses a lot to work, but some days I just wear like khakis with an Irma.
Yeah.
Or black pants with an Irma. Irma, if you're outside the US or you just don't know this, there's a company, who does leggings called LuLaRoe, and they also do like oversized shirts, which I really like their Irma because it covers up my ass completely. So when I'm bending over and getting books out of the book return, or when my children accidentally throw a book on the floor, like, no, it is accident. Like the book return, it's like a little cart, and sometimes I'll pull it out and they put it in thinking that the cart is there and it's not. So it goes on the floor. Then I can bend over and assume that no middle schooler is going to get flushed my back. Yeah. Anyway, this is more about me that you need and my outfits that you ever need to know.
You know, whatever makes you happy, my friend.
I have something else that I'm knitting.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, that's right.
Totally forgot.
You knit on this last night because the sweater was too big to bring to dinner.
It was. So I have an Amy Beth National Park bag, which is super cute. And in it, I have a sock. Ooh, my nail just caught on the zipper. Better the zipper than the knitting. So this is the Flintstones colorway of Desert Vista Dye Works. It goes from a sky blue to a brown to an orange to a purple to a white to a green. It's like a peach and back to the sky blue. So
it's like Fred and Wilma's clothing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's a good description. So I am knitting on that. And this is going to go with me to Portland. And hopefully get some work done on it in the plane or in the airport or just... hanging out.
What other knitting are you taking to Portland?
I have another pair of socks that I'm going to start. So I owe AE Hall a pair of Skype socks. And I'm going to knit those out of some, another Crafty Girl in this bluish gray colorway. So those will be, I have to find another pair of size zeros and I have to decide if I'm going to do double points or if I'm going to magic loop or I need to look at the pattern.
I have a zero, 40 inch if you need to magic loop.
Okay. I think I have one. I definitely have the interchangeable.
Oh, that's right. The Chaogu.
Chaogu, but I might have to go down to 00. Malia told me yesterday that I need to go down to 00.
I think she's right.
And Leslie has been telling me that, too.
Not because I want, because I hate her or anything, just because she's a very loose knitter.
She hates me. That's why I need to go down to a 00. But anyway.
I say as I knit on my size 6s.
I'm knitting the sweater in size 4s.
Wow. This is a sport weight. And I'm knitting it on 6s.
This is a sport. But I feel like these sports are different. Like,
yes, they are.
Like, this is definitely a
But this is also meant
sport.
To be a drapey. Like,
yeah.
It's not meant to hold any sort of shape. It won't hold any sort of shape.
I feel like this is more of a DK weight than a sport. It is labeled sport, but I got a gauge of 20 stitches to 4 inches. So 5 stitches to the inch. Mm-hmm. So I feel like that's more of a DK weight or a worst weight. Like Miss Babs Yowza, I get that. So I have Yowza to do a sweater too.
Yeah,
need to knit more sweaters. Someday. I would like to get 3 sweaters done before SSK. You should totally hold me to that. So this will count as 1. And then if I work on the flex, that's 2. You already have a breathing space, so I hate to put in another breathing space.
You don't have to just knit for the try-it-on room.
No, I'm going to knit for me, too. But,
I'd like to knit 2 more before SSK.
Yeah. And then Gwen has how many that she's supposed to knit for you?
A fair number.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we're just chatting.
Yep. I have no finished objects. Do you have any finished objects?
I have no spinning. Nope. All right, I'm gonna.
So we do have a book to review.
Right there for the moment. Yes. So let me switch. Oh my god, that's so far away. Nope, that's not it. There we go.
Yeah.
I just labeled it wrong. So we are reviewing the second in the coffee
series.
I was just gonna say flavored, and that is not the right word. Coffee themed series by
CC Almond.
Yep, CC and Dammy. Of the Geeky Girls podcast. It's also, CC also is behind Java Pearl Designs. Are they both with Java Pearl or is that just CC?
I think it's just CC.
I think so too. I'm sorry if I'm wrong. But it's a mother-daughter team.
And they do a mother-daughter podcast that has a geeky flavor to it.
Yeah, and it's been going
geeky
for quite
in a good
a while.
Way. Yeah. So this is a 7 pattern collection. It retails for $16.
Yeah.
And you can buy each pattern individually for $5.50 as well.
Mm-hmm.
Each sock pattern, there's what, 6 sock? No,
there's
5 sock patterns are written from toe up and top down.
Mm-hmm.
The first one is a baby set.
I do love you click on the link and it takes you there.
That's the best.
Magic.
So, this is sized all the way up from a baby size to an adult size. Mm-hmm. It is a textured pattern.
Yep. And there's a whole page that just gives you information about the pattern. What gauge is, needle size, the different sizes it comes in, and any specific notes that you need.
Some of these socks are in sport weight, and some of them, well, I guess they're DK weight.
It's all DK. It's written in DK.
And then some are fingering weight.
Mm-hmm.
So these are very colorful yarnings, DK weight, which is a U.S. company.
Sorry.
They use short row heels for the most part. Whoa.
I know. I shouldn't try to mess with this, but I just wanted to show the stitch pattern. It's a nice textured.
And you can see the short row heels on that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, let me go back to... There we go.
There are multiple pictures of each pattern.
Yep.
This is the second pattern.
It is instant coffee. We'll go back and just take a look at it. So it's a cool slip stitch textured pattern.
Yep. Again, they're written from the top down and the toe up.
Mm-hmm.
If they're charted, they have both charted and written directions.
Yep. And notations for different sizes as well.
Yep.
So there's a slightly closer view of that pattern.
And a glamour shot as well.
Mm-hmm. And then, sorry, I don't know the names of coffee things because I don't...
Leslie's
learned a lot.
Leslie's anti-coffee.
I just don't like the taste. But I learned a lot of what these things are by reading this, because I had no idea what a flat white was or what a baby chino was, because I don't drink coffee. So I actually learned quite a bit. So this is the espresso con panna, which is an espresso topped with whipped cream, for those who may not know. And it's got these sections of texture which are separated by a reverse stockinette stitch. So it's sort of a ringed look.
Yeah.
And same deal. It's written for many different sizes. It's written in, this one is written in fingering weight. There's a couple of DK, and I think the other three are fingering weight. It's got difficulty level down here.
This is 2 out of 3.
Yes. It's a medium versus a weak or a strong. For their grading system is coffee-based. So they do have nice big charts. You can sort of see it over here on the left, but I'm not going to click on it because that's the secret sauce. And then beauty shots down here, where you can see the texture a little bit better. And then next, we've got the chai latte sauce. And it's got sort of a teardrop effect.
Yeah. Again, slip stitches.
Mm-hmm. And this one is done in a self-striping pattern with the short row heel. And the description of the texture is that it's replicated from the look of the spices used in a chai latte. I have no idea what the spices used are, but I do like the texture, where it's sort of like dripping rain. You know, it's very linear. And then we've got another shot here with the chai latte. I have had a chai latte. Not that that's really relevant to this.
Then there's a wrap.
Yep, it's called the flat white. And it does have modifications for how to knit it as a skinnier sort of scarf or a cowl. So it does give you some information about how you can modify that information.
Yep.
And this is knit out of a fingering weight. There is a beauty shot a little farther down. Yeah, so you can really see the texture down here on the right. It reminds me a little, it's a different pattern, but it reminds me a little of the monkey stitch pattern.
Yeah.
It's a similar sort of line,
yeah,
which is very pleasing. It's, you know, one of the most popular patterns for a reason, because it's a pleasing effect.
Yep.
So, and then we've got hot chocolate pink marshmallows.
With pink
socks.
Marshmallows, yeah. Which is an XO cable.
Mm-hmm. And the cable charts are very clear. This is rated strong, or they're more difficult rating. The charts are very large and clear.
Yep.
And because it's a digital edition, you could zoom in if you wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's another beauty shot of the yarn. Then we've got one shot, two shot, three shot
fingerless mitts. You can do these at different lengths. Mm-hmm. They have a cable that moves around a little bit.
And it's on a bed of reverse stockinette. So the cables really pop.
Mm-hmm.
And it's knit, or it's, sorry, it's written for different circumferences of your hand.
And also, like, the name of the yarn is the Rusty Ferret, which might be the best name for a yarn company ever.
It is pretty interesting. I will definitely give it that. But yeah, so you can see how it knits up in the different sizes here. They do have a universal
abbreviations.
And as far as I could tell, it was all standard with what I've seen across other patterns. We do talk about their difficulty level as well. Light, not weak, I'm sorry. Medium and strong. And there's acknowledgments from both CC and Dammy. Just thanking the people who were involved with the book. And
yep.
Then there's a little bit about the pair themselves.
Yep.
So CC and Dammy, again, are part of the Geeky Girls podcast.
Oh, they both do Java Pearl Designs.
Okay. So, sorry, I stated that incorrectly earlier. And, you know, they look like they're having fun. So, again, this is the second book, second sock and accessory collection put out by
CC
and
Dammy.
And
you can buy the patterns individually, yep, like we stated earlier, or you can buy the whole collection. The whole collection is $16 US.
Mm-hmm.
You can buy it on Ravelry, or it's $5.50 an individual pattern.
Yep. So, and that just came out this week. So yep. Thank you to the Geeky Girls for sending it to us for review.
Yep.
I talked a lot now.
Okay, so things
we're very graceful with our segues.
So, things that we're reading. I read two very good books this week, very different genres. The first I read was The Hidden Oracle. It's a Rick Riordan book. It's his newer series, is The Trials of Apollo. So Apollo is a Greek god, and Zeus has sent him to Earth as a teenage boy with zits, and he's removed his godlike powers.
Oh.
And so it's typical Rick Riordan, very funny, very quest, Greek mythology. Rick says that Greek mythology is the original soap operas. So it's got a little bit of everything in it. I enjoyed it. Quick read. The second one comes out. The reason why I read it now is the second one comes out later this month. And my kids were giving me crap because I always read like the first book in a series, and I never read the rest of the books in the series because there's my pile of new books. Like,
I feel like
over.
That's not true. It's just not true for your school books.
Well, that's true. So I am woefully behind on my Rick Riordan. I have the second Magnus Chase to read, and I have like the third, fourth, and fifth of the series that Trials of Apollo comes after. So
oh.
It kind of like gave away a little yeah. bit of what happened. So I need to go back and read that, The Son of Neptune and that whole series. The problem is, like, there's a year between the books. This
mm-hmm.
is my excuse. And after a year goes by, it's hard for me to, like, remember
yes.
what happened in the first book. So
for me, for books that I really love, I'll go back and read it again.
Yes, and
but
I'll do that too, but
I have to love it
thick,
to invest that much time in it.
And it's a school book, and I can read, like, three other books just as fast as that one book. Makes it hard, but my kids and I, my students and I, were setting goals about our reading, and we did a quick write about it, and I was co-teaching with the teacher, and he did his quick write is to read more, like we set a goals, and his goal is to read more fiction by the end of the year, because he reads primarily nonfiction, and my goal was to read more books in series and read more nonfiction, so we're recommending books to each other, which, like, was not pre-planned,
mm-hmm.
but worked out really, really well. And talked about, like, where we came from at the beginning of the school year. Like, one of the things that I've been trying to pay more attention to is reading more graphic novels. Because my kids love graphic novels.
Yeah.
And I want to read them more often. And I really enjoy graphic novels when I get a chance to read them. I think they get a bad rap. But they're actually kind of harder to read in some ways because you have to be paying attention to both the pictures and the text because
mm-hmm.
sometimes there's nuances that you don't catch if you're just looking at text. Anyway, sorry to librarian out on you. So I read the Hidden Oracle, and then I read an absolutely fabulous YA book. It is upper YA. It is called The Hate U Give. I'm not going to give it to any of my kids below 8th grade. It does have a lot of cussing in it. It does have a lot of adult situations. But it is such a good book. It is about a girl. And when she was...
Don't give it all away because I haven't read it
yet. I'm not going to give it all away.
Okay.
When she was 10, she saw her... It was like her and her best friend and her other best friend. So her and her one best friend were playing in a fire hydrant. And there was a drive-by, and her best friend was killed.
Mm.
And at that point, her parents decided to send her to a private school where she's basically the only African-American kid. There's one other boy and her siblings. And so she adopts a persona when she's at that school
mm.
versus when she's at home in kind of a rough area. It's not kind of a rough area. It's a rough area. Her dad owns, like, the local grocery store. And really, he's keeping it open for the community so that they have some place to buy groceries.
Yeah.
She is at a party that she's not supposed to be at, but she kind of gets told she's going by a friend. And she goes, and when she's there, she runs into her other friend that she hasn't seen in a while because they don't go to school together. And his grandmother, who's raising him, has been diagnosed with cancer, and they're just, like, catching up. So they decide, there's gunfire at the party, they decide to leave and go, there was like a gang issue that broke out at the party. They decide to leave, and as he's driving her home, he gets pulled over by a police officer. And it's really, really, it makes you empathize, because if I got pulled over, I would not feel the way that she feels.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely, coming from two white women, we're talking from a position of privilege that, you know, we have without having to do anything for it.
Yes. So, it's easy to empathize, and from there, it continues on. He's, her friend is shot and killed by the police officer, and she's the only witness. So if you are looking for a book that is going to put you in someone else's shoes and have you empathize for a different situation, this would be a good book for that. Excellent. Not just a good book. An excellent book.
Laura's talked about it at least four times since
like,
she read
it's
to
so
me.
Good. Yeah. In fact, like, there is now a list of teachers at my school to read it before we put it on the shelf. And I'm just going to, like, I bought it with my own money, and I'm probably going to buy two more copies when we go to Powell's in Portland with my own money, because I want to support indie bookstores, too. We lost our only independent bookstore. New bookstore in Memphis, and that kills me because that's where I've seen so many authors, and they would get in a lot of authors for signing, plus they had the best tomato soup in the world.
They did.
So I want to support Powell's while we're in Portland, and that's important to me, but this is a really, really good book, and I read it in like 3 hours, and I want to go back. Like, it's so good that I was taking pictures of quotes to go back and think about later. But one of my coworkers wanted it next. I actually had taken it for him to borrow, because I was like, I'm not going to get time to read this over break. I've got this retreat going on. And then what I had planned for Friday fell through. I was supposed to go to a CEU. That was actually Thursday, and I totally forgot about it. Oops. So I stole it back from him and read the book in 3 hours. And so he texted me today, and he's like, oh my gosh! And so we had to just, like, it's so good that we were having a long discussion about it over spring break when teachers are supposed to be breaking, but teachers never really break. But, anyway, if you're looking for a diverse selection to build empathy or as a reflection of you yourself, it's a really, really good book. Anyway, so that's what I've been reading. I'm going to read, like, another Rick Riordan or something silly, because I've been doing, like, a lot of intense books with Flying Lessons and Ms. Bixby's Last Day, and then The Hate U Give, which is a Tupac reference.
Oh, is it?
Okay. Like, part of the reason the book took me so long to read is I had to ask some of my coworkers what certain words meant.
Yeah.
But also, like, I have very little Tupac
knowledge,
like, there's definitely a gap.
Well, I
there.
Mean, he was killed in what, like, 90
when I was in middle school. He was, well, Kurt was, Cobain committed suicide when I was in 7th grade.
That was 94. Don't ask me how I know that.
But so speaking of Kurt Cobain, this is a super random reference. The woman who wrote Slave Dancer, whose last name is Fox, and she won a Newbery Award for that, recently died. And so there was an obituary from her that I was reading, and she is the grandmother of Courtney Love.
Oh.
Which I thought was really, really interesting.
Yeah, random fact.
But yeah, your random fact for the day.
The more you know.
Anyway. So what have you been reading? Because I've been talking about, and I could continue talking.
You really
for
could.
A while.
And people would learn things, but not everybody wants us to talk for 20 minutes about books. So, so I finished reading the third book in the Innkeeper series by Alana Andrews. I don't know why I hadn't read it.
There's kissing in that book.
There is. Finally.
I know.
It's a very slow burn until you get to that point, but Curran is,
that's a different series.
Yes.
Though.
He was a really good, dynamic character.
Yeah,
he was
alpha
the main
male
love interest in that series, the
you
Kate Daniels
my
series.
Things too far away
sorry,
from me.
I was gonna once we get to the yarn, I was gonna
and you
use
linked
this
them
camera.
All together.
I'm sorry, I was trying to be helpful. My idea of helpful is different from yours, clearly. Even though I think he was a really great love interest, there's something about this Innkeeper series that Alana Andrews wrote. I just love it so much. I think it's because so the basic premise is that there are these innkeepers, and inns are sort of galactic waypoints for all these different species.
They're safe havens.
Yes, and so the innkeeper has lots and lots of really unique abilities and talents when she's inside the inn, because she draws on the power of the inn, and it's this sort of symbiotic relationship. Really interesting, but I think it's because it's a very modern, contemporary book, and they introduce all sorts of different characters and races.
Yeah, and aliens.
In a very, this is the way it is, and there's no, fanfare about it. You know, this is the species, and this is what they require, and I don't know.
And there's no judgment either.
Yeah, that could be a very good part of it. I just love that freaking series, and I wish there were a dozen books.
No judgment here. Hey, so have you read the Edge series?
Yes. Okay, I don't like that as much.
George from the Edge series, did you catch that?
Uh-uh.
Is the Arbitrary Trader in the second Innkeeper series.
Huh.
And Jack, his brother, is in it as well.
It's been a while since I've read the Edge series. Well, a while. It's been 100 books or so since I've read the Edge series.
Yeah, so that's linked. Those two series are linked.
Yeah. I don't know. I really love...
In a subtle way. You don't have to read the Edge series to...
It's just neat to see that character crossover.
Yeah.
Anyway, if you are interested in sort of contemporary
paranormal
romance,
it's little on the romance, more, I would call it urban
but
fiction.
It's very fast paced.
Yeah.
I found it was one of those that I ended up reading really quickly, even though I wanted to go really slow because I loved it. It was such a good book.
Have you read her Silver Shark series?
I don't think so.
That's a good one too. Again, short stories, but also very good.
Okay. Well, I'll add it to my list. So I finished that. I started it and finished it in a couple of days. I did finish listening to Empire of Storms. In my head, it was the final book. It's totally not the final book.
No.
And it leaves on a huge cliffhanger. Enormous cliffhanger. And then the next book isn't out until November, I think. So
I hate that because then I forget what happened.
I know. That's why I had just gone back and re-listened to everything, because I thought this was the final book, and it's totally not. Which is my own fault. I started the so C.L. Wilson wrote a book that I read last year called The Winter King that I really liked. So
the second one has still not come out.
It was supposed to come out last
two years ago,
and then it just keeps getting pushed back and back because I pre-ordered it, and every time they updated the date I got a notification. Then finally they said, oh, you know, there's no notification, there's no date at this point. Anyway, so C.L. Wilson wrote a book I really liked, and I decided to go back and try some of her other books. So there's a series called the Terran Soul series, which is about Fae and humans, and there's another race called the Eld, which are the bad guys. They're magicians, but they're they use the dark magic. So
they're the Darth Vaders of the Elven world.
So I finished the first one. It's not as fast paced as other books, but it's got a lot of meat to it. So I downloaded the second one and I'm reading it. And then Laura recommended I start the Encrypted series by Seanan McGuire.
Yeah. She's another series too that's more fae.
I typically am not a fae person, but as long as they're not written in such a way where they're prancing around their trees and, happy little elves, then it's fine. Bad guy fade, I'm okay with.
As long as they're not the happiest little elf,
yes,
you're fine.
They need to have some misery. Elves need misery. That's the rule. I started the Encrypted series, which I'm only 10% into, but it seems pretty good so
10%
far.
10% into the first book.
Yeah,
right?
The first book.
Yeah, because there's six books.
And so far it's a chick who's got a whole race of mice who worship her family.
Heslin mice. Yeah. They're amazing.
It's very funny. It's Very interesting.
So she is, she looks for encryptids, like species, like dragons,
yeah,
or lizards, or
anything paranormal,
anything Medusa, like, or things that are not supposed to exist that mm-hmm. do exist. But there's like scientific reasons behind their existence, so it kind of has more of a sciencey spin. But all she wants to do is be a ballroom dancer.
Mm-hmm.
And there is another... So her family just kind of observes these creatures.
Helps
and
where they can.
Helps if they have an issue. They'll help them out. And there's this other...
Organization
that's like knights that just want to kill mm-hmm. everything. And so she kind of has to try to stay underneath the radar. Mm-hmm. But she meets a knight.
She just met him. Don't ruin it for me.
She meets a knight. That's all I can tell you because I'm still sitting here. Sorry.
It's good so far. I'm going to have to download a couple of books for the trip. If anybody has recommendations, I do need a new audiobook for the trip because sometimes I'm in the mood to listen and sometimes I'm not. I'm good on books, but I need a new audiobook recommendation. So if anybody has any, let me know.
We have a giveaway.
Mm-hmm. So, Gail of Gail's Art is a wonderful person.
She is. She does some awesome stuff.
Yes. Super knowledgeable and always willing to share that knowledge with yes. anybody who asks. And her color scheme, like her favorite colors are usually my favorite colors. So, I never have a problem finding something I like in Gail's booths. Lately, it's been something I like and don't own. Because I've been buying from Gail for a lot of years.
She has some really interesting blends of, like, yak, mm-hmm. silk.
And I've bought several of her colors more than once because they're just so dang pretty.
They are.
And in different blends. So, anyway, Gail does a sock blend club.
She does.
And she's always been a great supporter of our show and our retreat and all that. Would you stop tossing stuff on my floor?
I was putting it in my bag. Jeez.
She's totally a liar right there. Anyway, Gail is, we just love her. She's great. And she's doing a giveaway for a free spot in her 3-month
Ooh.
sock blank club, which is wonderful because Gail's wonderful.
So this one's vacation. Mm-hmm. So it's like New York, Yellowstone, and what's the third?
I don't know.
Eloise purchased it, and I'm purchasing the Yellowstone one off of her, because she doesn't like the colors in it, but I am all yeah. about them, so.
I like that she tells you that ahead of time.
Yeah, she shows you what you're getting, yeah. so you know exactly what's happening.
And she's very fair on her pricing, and, you know, her color range is pretty diverse, especially with the blanks. So she's giving away a free membership, which is somewhere in the, like, $80 to $100 value range.
Yeah.
I don't remember exactly what it is with shipping. And so to enter
around 100,
we will open a thread on our Ravelry group, and all you have to do is tell us what your favorite vacation spot or ideal vacation is. Pictures are always welcome because they might be used as like a colorway idea later. You never know.
What's your favorite vacation spot? Or dream vacation spot?
Super not dream vacation would include snorkeling on the Great Barrier Reef, playing with kangaroos, baby wombats, and really just spending time on a quiet beach watching the waves. Like, just quiet. That's pretty much my ideal. What about
Can
you
tell that Leslie's introverted?
Just a little bit.
I don't know. So.
I enjoy spending time with people, but my happy place is by myself.
So, right now, I really want to go to Harry Potter Land.
Yeah.
Like.
I do, too, but not if there's other people there. And there's never so not.
Fucking ridiculous. So, I want to go to Harry Potter Land. Acadia National Park in Maine is one of my favorite places I've ever been to. It's my favorite national park that I've been to, so I would like to go back there for sure. I don't know, the world's so big.
Yeah.
There's so many places I haven't been.
Ditto.
There's 6 states I haven't been to yet. So
we had dinner with Malia, Rhymes with Malia, who had a fantastic podcast, which I hope she gets to it back to at some point, and her husband Noah. They're doing a road trip, and they were talking about how Noah's only got
two
Malia's only got two. Noah's got three.
Malia's got, like, North Dakota and Wisconsin, which is super weird to
very
me.
Yeah, random. Because she lives in Indiana, so, I mean, it's not, like, right there, but it's not far.
Yeah. And Noah's got Oklahoma, North Dakota.
And something else. Or maybe just those two. I don't know. And so, by what we mean by that is having visited every state except those. I'm only, like, in the 20s, maybe 30s. I haven't counted. Laura's only got six that she hasn't been to, so. Anyway. So, if you want to enter, we'll leave that up until we record again, which will probably be Monday, possibly Tuesday of next week, just depending on how exhausted we are after the retreat. So, we'll leave that up until we record the next time. Also, for those of you who are in Portland or in the metro area and who are not able to come to the retreat, we are having a meetup.
Yay!
On Wednesday night, which will be the 15th, we are meeting up at Twisted, the yarn shop in Portland.
We need to put a thread about that in the Ravelry group as well.
We're going to be meeting there from 6:30 until 8. The lovely folks at Twisted are staying open a little bit late for us.
We're going to have cupcakes.
We're bringing lovely gourmet cupcakes, even some that are vegan and some that are gluten-free, because we love you all, no matter what your food preference is.
Plus, Gwen's gluten-free, so we have to include her in stuff, otherwise she gets grouchy.
Yeah. or she gets grouchy because we gave her, like, a list of 100 things to do. Either one of those is possible. So, anyway.
If you were to meet Gwen, you would be like, she's never grouchy, which is pretty true. Yeah,
she's pretty great. So, if you're able to come to Twisted from 6:30 to 8, come, say hi, hang out for a little while. Maybe you'll find something that you love at the shop.
I'm sure there's going to be some things that we love at the shop.
Yeah. No doubt.
I'm hoping they got Republic of Wool in.
I can't answer that. But I have Arwen's email. You can always email Arwen. anyway, so if you're in the Portland area and you're interested in coming and saying hi, we'll be at Twisted Wednesday night.
Yep. With cupcakes.
Yes. And let's see, what else? Oh, we, for those of you who are coming to SKP, Spring Knit Together Portland, this week, only 3 days away, we have a bunch of door prizes that were sent that we wanted to show you. But if you're not interested in door prizes and you're not going to Portland, then you're welcome to sign off. Or you can just look at the pretty yarn. I mean, that's what I would do. So I'm going to switch
more than pretty
here
yarn
and add.
And I'm going to move stuff.
Video capture device. And make this so that we can show you. Down on the thingy.
Ooh, look, it's Leslie's keyboard.
Goodness. Let me move this. Sorry, this is the work surface here.
So we have two bags from Slanted Stitches. They are cute little button bags that open into like a square that you can carry, and they've got an outside pocket. I'm doing a poor job of Vanna-ing upside down for me. So these are from Slanted Stitches, who's my friend Joanne, and she's local here in Memphis, and she always supports us. So we have two in purple. You might have to beat out Teresa Roberts for one of them. She's kind of abusive with the purple stuff.
She does love her purple.
Malabrigo sent
us... That looks so much brighter than it is.
Malabrigo sent us a ton of stuff, which is very, very sweet. Some of it is for SSK, and some of it is for SKP. This is Malabrigo Rasta, which is their super bulky in the Indicita colorway, which is really pretty. It's got blues. It's much deeper than this is portraying it, but it's really, really pretty. They also sent, we have a nice variety of all their different colorways, but also their different weights. This is Mecca. This is a light, bulky yarn. Mm-hmm. This is the, is that Pearl 10? No. This is the Plumo colorway. Pearl 10 is a great gray that they do as well. I used a lot of this to knit some Claire Devine hats last year.
Oh, yeah, from the tea collection.
So, yeah, from the tea collection. So that's a good one. We also have some purple. This is Arroyo.
In the purpurous colorway?
Yeah, so this is more of a DK weight.
Mm-hmm. Multi-strand.
I gave Leslie a sweater that I knit out of this for Camp Loopy a couple of years ago. Not this colorway, a dark blue. But it was really, really nice to knit with. And I enjoyed it immensely. We also have... Is this their silk alpaca?
Indecita.
Oh. Indecita in the finito base. It's 200 yards of a kettle-dyed merino weight yarn. It looks like it's more of a sport weight, but really, really pretty.
Yeah, nice and soft.
Yes.
You're going to make a mess. I don't know why you're pretending like you're not going to.
This is the...
Quigue.
Colorway of Rios. Rios is one of my favorite superwash merinos.
It's great.
It's like a heavy worsted, kind of an Aran, 210 yards per skein. It's great for sweaters, or this would be great for a Field of Wildflowers hat by Hohe. It's really, really a nice variegated colorway. You could do quite a bit with that.
And you can go a little fancy and do like a baby sweater with it, and still it's a really nice yarn.
Yeah. This is fuchsia in the lace weight. Their lace is a single strand of baby merino wool. It's super soft. It's 470 yards. And this is super bright.
It's like a jasmine pink.
Yes. That's a good description.
Or a CC pink.
The last Malabrigo that we have. This is their brand new base, which I haven't played with. This is the lettuce colorway.
And the caracal.
This is a 90-yard bulky weight. Mm-hmm. It's plied with a black strand.
Yeah. Hobie knit a little vest out of this.
Yeah, she did. Super cute.
Yeah, it would be a great hat.
I want to try some stuff out of that. We have four skeins of Heirloom Ornamental from Into the Worlds.
Yes, and it's actually much more purple and red than it's showing up on screen.
Yeah, I think it's like an Heirloom Tomatoes-based colorway, but Into the World gave us four skeins. We're going to divide this into two lots of two. It is their resist-dyed...
Pikaku sock?
Yes. So 460 yards. So that would give you enough to do one of Hohe or Vera's shawls, like Line Break.
Yep.
That would be super pretty in that.
Yeah, it's almost 1,000 yards, so.
Huckleberry Knits sent us a skein.
Yes.
I cannot open that
collection.
It's really, really, it's a dark green. In her willow base, which is a blue-faced luster, 80%, 20% nylon. This is the North Fork colorway. So really, really pretty. Yeah. Deep, intense green.
Yeah, with little pops of the brighter color coming through in spaces. So that is from Huckleberry Knits.
Yeah. And we have two skeins from Gail's Art. This looks like one of her Elvis colorways. Let's see if I'm right. This is Wonder Sock. Black and blue on gray. I was totally wrong.
It does look a little like blue suede shoes, though.
And then this one is the same.
Yep. It's just on a... This one is on a gray base, and this one's on a white base.
Yeah. So you can see the difference. Mm-hmm. That's super cool.
Yeah. Gail is super cool that way. She also sent us a gradient set.
Ooh. Is that in here?
That's... Yep.
Is it that's this it. One? Ooh, that's pretty.
This is her MYS, I think.
Her yak base.
It's the merino yak and silk, and it is, I think, 600 and something yards. Let me look. Oh, I'm sorry, 900 total yards.
Oh, so that would be a gorgeous shawl. That would be really pretty for, what's the variegate that I did the shawl? Oh, the Vera pattern, and then you did it too. But I used the Knit Girls gradient color, or the neon gradient color from Fiber Optic. What's the name of that shawl?
Stripe Study.
Yeah, that would be a really pretty Stripe Study.
Yeah, with a solid accent.
And then we have Denise Bell, Lost City Knits, her book.
Ultima Thule. Thule. Sorry, I don't know which it is. Which we've reviewed on the show before.
It's a great
book.
But
this book. Is a paper version of the book. And it does have a download code in the back. But yeah, it's got all of her beautiful... patterns and essays from her husband in there as well.
Chris. Great pictures in that one. We've got two skeins from Madeline Tosh. This is Vintage in the Outlander colorway. And then this looks like well water. Nope, rainwater.
Close.
And Vintage. I think rain. That might be what I did the sweater out of.
You did one in one of the two. Well, yeah. Water or rainwater. I can't remember.
So some
which.
Really pretty. Again, that would be perfect for Field of Wildflowers, that hohi pattern. Mm-hmm. For the speckle, for sure. Or a baby sweater for the other one. We have a gradient kit.
Yes.
From Dragonfly Fibers. This is the Cheshire Cat. It is her traveler base. It's 840 yards of like a DK weightish. Mm-hmm. Really, really pretty. For sure. And that's a nice soft yarn as well.
Yep.
We have from Turtle Pearl Yarns, which is a self-striping yarn company.
Yep, out of Canada.
Yep, this is her trench coat.
It's an overdyed version of trench coat.
Okay.
Trench coat is usually sort of Burberry colored, sort of a tan, black, red, and white. And this is an overdyed version of that. And it's a limited edition, so it's a very sort of one-of-a-kind set. So, and they're in separate skeins, so you can be as obsessive compulsive about your matching as you like. That's Gwen's.
Oh, I'm like, where did this come from? I'm opening Gwen's
you
mail.
You totally are.
All right. We have some other stuff. This is
from... Oh, I turned the thing off.
Oh, I'll show it up there. This is from Gecko Yarns.
Yes.
Look at this pretty gradient.
So pretty. I'm totally buying some of this once we finish recording.
Oh, this is a better.
Yep.
So really, really pretty. It comes with a little Gecko stitch marker. Mm-hmm. Lori Berger's the dyer behind Gecko Yarns. This is called Shades of Raspberry. It's 274 yards of a DK weight, mm-hmm. like heavy sport. And then...
Laura's got the bag of stuff.
I do. I think this is the last thing. Yep. We have a mini skein club
from Space Cadet.
Who's out of Pittsburgh, and yeah. She does gorgeous mini skeins, and you can work from one. Like, there's always a corresponding color.
Mm-hmm.
This would be cool if you got several of these to do, like, a find your fade.
Yeah.
That kind of went together.
You could get the full size of those colors.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. If she sells them, that would be really, really cool.
Yeah.
So, really, really pretty. Thank you, Space Cadet.
Yes.
And there's also a wee Euclid wash in there as well.
And a lot of these vendors were very kind and included some discount codes, which we'll put in the goodie bags for the folks that are attending SKP. But we do want to thank all of our vendors who sent in door prizes. We also have some skeins of Volmiza that we'll be including as well. Those were given to us by private donors for our events. So we're pretty sure we'll have almost enough for everybody, like almost the same number of prizes as we have attendees, which is great. And let's see, what else? Is that it for this week?
I think that's it. We will see you in Portland if you're attending SKAP.
Or the meetup,
yep. Mm-hmm. If not, we hope you have a good week. Happy Pi Day, happy Ides of March, happy St. Patrick's Day. Mm-hmm. All these things are this week.
They
it's very exciting. that's really funny. Hopefully I will have this sweater done by
you
tonight.
You totally will.
That's the plan. All right, we will see you guys next time. Have a good night, y'all.
Have a great week. Bye.
Bye.